Okay, now how will this pan out, considering that we are also having joint patrols with other nations? There are plans, of course, with the U.S. and other nations are also expected to join or have expressed their intentions to join. What kind of message will that send China if we do not do a similar activity with them?
Well, I think that doing a similar activity with them really should be out of the question, given that they are claiming the West Philippine Sea, and we've seen them act aggressively towards our Coast Guard and our Navy. So joint patrols, joint exercises with China there would be completely out of sync with our position and our efforts. And I think it will be counterproductive as well. We would essentially be showing off to them what we can do and what we have and how we do things. And for China, I think it's a major point of interest for them, precisely to see how our armed forces operate. And they would certainly love to listen in on, say, communications and find out everything about our assets. And a joint patrol would expose us to that possibility. So that's why I wouldn't even consider it. We have commitments from our traditional allies and friends who have also given their commitments to help us protect the West Philippine Sea precisely from China's incursions and their aggressive behavior and their expansion. So I would actually just go with that and not consider joint patrols with China. It would send, I think, a kind of a confusing or self-contradictory signal in fact.
Right. Right. Okay. Now, the tensions in the disputed territory does not show signs of abating. In fact, Senator Risa Ontiveros had proposed another case with the United Nations, one that has been amended and filed as Resolution Number 718, which is to rally and engage by reasserting our claims before an international body. Now, I'd like to ask two questions about this. First, will another action against China before the UN be advantageous for the Philippines? And second, what opportunity are we missing if we don't pursue this?
Well, if first, let's clarify what you mean by action before the UN, because the UN is not a court. Any action within the UN system is essentially a political action. And so you need to campaign or work on getting other nations to basically join you in your position.
Right.
So it's really more for harnessing political support in the hope that that kind of political pressure will make China change its behavior. So doing that before the UN, I think, has always been in the long-term strategy of the Philippines when it originally embarked on this arbitration. Unfortunately, it got delayed by an intervening administration. But now that they seem to be going back to that track, then I think that it can be pursued. That being said, though, it's not something that, you know, it's not instant results. The UN system is also very, in a way, complex politically. Countries, there are many countries, almost 200 countries, each one looking out for their interests, each one trying to push their respective agendas. So the Philippines is only one of those several hundred countries. So I would say that even though this, it should be seen as a long-term strategy, long-term plan, long-term action, that really is that has to cross even administrations. It's not something that when you file a resolution, you expect immediate results in your favor. So that's why it's important for the Philippines also to strategize and calibrate even its activities in the UN. Because we also have many other things on the plate for the UN. There are also things that we need from the UN. And so we need to always be balancing that. And so you have to look at things like the right timing, the right amount of support. So and that really is the province of DFA and the mission in New York. It will have to be up to them to decide on that.
All right. Speaking of the intervening administration, there's this matter on former President Rodrigo Duterte, who visited Xi Jinping on a personal capacity. Now, what are the impacts of that visit, particularly what he told Chinese President, as relayed by President Marcos to, in his words, "Please be kind to my country"? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, of course, it's unusual. and inappropriate, I think, personally, because you're the former president and now you're acting as a messenger, essentially as an ambassador of a foreign country. Mm-hmm. Doing that, no? So given that he was the former president, I think that it was even from the viewpoint of optics and political theater, it's not something that benefits the Philippines, but rather something that benefits China, I think. Mm-hmm. Nonetheless, given that he decided to take on that role and be China's envoy to the current administration, mm-hmm. to be the one to deliver the messages, no? Which I assume he did in his meeting with the president. Hmm. The Philippines needs to be open as well to receiving all kinds of communications from all quarters. Hmm. No? So it's just that we don't have to take those communications from all of these sources at face value. Some of them might be disinformation, some of them might be, they all have to go through the vetting process as well. You know, all have to be assessed, and they also all have to be considered in light of other circumstances and the context. No, so I would take former President Duterte's action and messages simply as that. No, mm-hmm. messaging, another way by which China is attempting to show that it has channels open to the Philippines. That's all. But I wouldn't base my decision solely on that.
Okay, and do you think the former president should be given a role in the first place in terms of managing Philippines-China relations? Because some senators think having him there would be very helpful.
Helpful to who? I mean, it's pretty clear that the policies and thoughts of the former president, especially when it comes to the West Philippine Sea, are opposed to the current policy and positions of this administration. So having him in that position, I think, would be problematic, to say the least. Mm-hmm. No? And to be in the middle between the Philippines and China on such a critical matter as the West Philippine Sea, you do not want a middleman who might be a loose cannon, so to speak. No? Mm-hmm. And so I don't think it would be wise, really, despite his... Uh-huh. Affinity for and to Xi Jinping, mm-hmm. We have to keep in mind that what our affinity should remain with the Philippines.
All right. Lastly, Professor, on moves to be more intentional about teaching the West Philippine Sea conflict in schools, do you see this as an opportunity to instill or even improve the sense of nationalism of our youth?
Definitely. Number one, knowledge of the West Philippine Sea, the full extent of our maritime jurisdictions, our area, our territory, basically. This should be basic information for every Filipino citizen. And unfortunately, for many decades, even up to college and even law school, this is not even discussed in detail. So that's why we still have these disputes and we still have internal debates. We have people taking sides with the other countries, for mm-hmm. example, even though they're Filipino. Because basic information about our position and the extent of our national territory and jurisdictions is simply not provided. So definitely we need to include that in the educational system. Mm-hmm. It can enhance nationalism in the sense that knowledge of what it is that is at stake, what it is that it is ours. You have uncertainty of our rights and entitlements, no? Gives you that sense of certainty, no? Personally and nationally, about what you need to fight for. And in the current context, where disinformation, misinformation, misdirection, and gaslighting has become even national policy for some other countries, that kind of certainty is essential. So I think we really should pursue that as well.
All right, Professor Batambakal, I just would like to go back to our top story, Philippine-U.S. joint patrols and other countries, of course, expressing to join these exercises. What do you think? Will it further raise tensions between China and the Philippines? And can we expect retaliation given that China sees this really as a provocation?
Well, when you think about it, if it does raise tensions, the tensions emerge because of China mm-hmm. and how it reacts. to these patrols. These patrols taking place in the West Philippine Sea and in the high seas or in international waters should not by themselves be provocative and should not by themselves lead to tensions if the other country accepted that those waters are not theirs, or those waters are international waters. Mm. So if ever tensions rise, it's only because China is the one that raises them. For us, I think it is actually helpful having the presence of not just the United States, but all other countries in the South China Sea, exercising their lawful rights and freedoms in accordance with international law, demonstrates that all of these countries are trying to abide by and defend the international legal system under which we have all benefited, even China. No? Without this system, which has been in place since the end of the Second World War, the independent countries of Southeast Asia, for example, would not exist, and the global economy, the international community as we know it now, would not exist, because maritime trade is the lifeblood of that international community and that global economy. And China, its positions, its claim to the entire South China Sea simply is a direct threat to that. So we should actually be supportive of this move. No? And we should see it as a way for us to work together in defending the international legal system, which China is opposing.
All right. Professor J. Batombacal, Director of UP Institute for Maritime Affairs and the Law of the Sea, thank you so much for your insights and thanks for joining us.
Welcome, Stanley, and good afternoon again to all our tell viewers.